So, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very glad that you can join us on this sunny day in the Netherlands. It's 4 o'clock, so let's start this webinar about our research that we did on the state of GDPR readiness in Europe. I'm very keen on sharing these results with you because there are really some cool findings, and we really see that during the last months there were some developments in how organizations are compatible to the law. If you have any questions during the webinar, just try to ask them through the chat function. And I will see if we have some time at the end of the webinar to answer the questions. Otherwise, I could contact you personally with some of the questions and answers. And what's also nice to know is that the report about this fifth measurement that we did about the research will be available after the webinar on our website. And I will all send all the attendees an email with the link so that you will also have the written report on the research. So let's start now. My name is Esther Hoeksema. I'm a marketing executive at iWelcome, and I have been involved in the research from the beginning. So what you see over the last few months, there were more and more market studies on GDPR compliancy. A lot of those studies were questionnaires that were sent to DPOs to let them put some checklists. Do you have this in place? Do you have that in place? And what we were thinking, GDPR is really about a new mindset. It's about what it is for the consumer, putting the consumer back in control of their data. So we took another angle, and we believe that the proof of the pudding is in the eating. So we went, well, kind of undercover, and we acted like consumers that register with large organizations in Europe. So we chose 89 of the largest organizations over different countries in Europe, and we looked how ready those organizations were for GDPR from a consumer's perspective. So, and we scored these organizations on how compliant their consumer journeys, so their register processes, their privacy policies, the way they point out the different GDPR rights to customers, and how clear that is. So that's what we did with our research. So the scope of our research was seven different countries across Europe. So we took the whole, actually the whole range from north to south, Sweden, Germany, the Netherlands, Switzerland, France, Spain, and the UK, of which I need to add that Switzerland is not an EU country, but whenever organizations interact with European citizens, they need to be compliant to GDPR. Plus, Switzerland has reformed its own privacy laws, and by the end of the year, they will also come into force. And the Swiss privacy law is actually very similar to GDPR, so Switzerland needs to conform to the same standards as the other European countries in the end. We did a research over six different verticals, also to see if there is if there are major differences. You've got verticals that consumers interact with on a frequent basis, like retail, like media and publishing. There are also verticals that interact with consumers on a not so frequent basis, like for example, an insurance. You only buy it once, and after that, you interact on a different basis. For all these verticals, we also checked on different capabilities. So we watched which GDPR requirements are easy to measure in a consumer journey and are really applicable on a consumer journey. And these are the eight that we thought were, not too hard to investigate and also very important to have a good customer journey. Consent is very important, the ability to withdraw your consent, the right of access, the right of rectification, the right to erasure, so actually the right to be forgotten eventually, a data retention period, how long are your data stored, privacy by default, Do you get email newsletters that you actually didn't want and stuff like that? And special categories of data. Those special categories of data is not always applicable. So we did not investigate all the companies and the organizations that we monitored on this requirement, but only when we found that it was really something that they processed. And we have got five different measurements that we did. We started in October, November 2017. So that was the first measurement. Then in January, we had a second report. In March, we had another one. Early May, so just before GDPR. And today we're comparing that one to our June measurements that we just recently did. And that I'm happy to share now because we now really see the difference with before GDPR and after GDPR. And we used a scoring mechanism for the overall compliancy based on the 8 different requirements that we have. So organizations could score based on these requirements, they could score points, and all the points together resulted in a scoring from uncompliant across the board to almost or fully compliant. Well, we have had some key findings that I would like to tease you with. I'm going to explain a bit more about that later in the process and in the webinar. The ratio before and after GDPR reversed. Before GDPR, it was 2/3 of organizations that was still uncompliant across the majority of the requirements. And now we see that 1/3 of organizations is still uncompliant. And so actually a lot has happened. What we also see, GDPR is a checklist, not a mindset. That is something that I will continue on later on as well. The UK scored highest, followed by Sweden and Germany. And we've got retail and e-tail and consumer goods as the best performing industry. And that was the same 5 times in a row. So they have been the best in the beginning and they're still the best. So they have really evolved during those months as well. And yeah, I think we can call this industry front runner when it comes to GDPR. So I'd like to take you through all the different measure of all the different requirements that we measured. We're starting with consent. Consent is one of the most complicated ones that we had, and this is also one where consumers where organizations could score multiple points on. We had different questions that we asked while we were registering on the websites of the organizations. Is consent being asked for in a straightforward manner? Are the purposes of use mentioned at all? Does the organization clarify for what purpose the personal data will be used? And is that crystal clear? And are the purposes of use specified per attribute? So if you, for example, give an email address, is it clear that for what purposes the email address will be used? There are, of course, data, personal data that you need for lawful purposes. So when that was the case, we did not look at the consent aspect, but a lot of organizations ask for more data than they actually need. So that is where consent comes in. And we were able to measure that very well during the whole process. And what we see is the score per country in November. Versus the score per country in June, that is in the graphs that you see in this sheet. You see quite a development. There's a lot more of the bright green on the top of the bars. And we see that the United Kingdom is number one when it comes to consent. We see that Germany really developed very well. We see some development in Sweden as well. We see that France really stays behind when it comes to consent. And we see that Switzerland also stays a bit behind, which can be explained by the fact that they don't have to comply to their own privacy laws yet. But overall, you see the improvement in consent here. So the United Kingdom scores highest. They have quite a few front runners, companies that do really well. And that is, of course, easier than for other companies to have an example and to also implement similar things in their customer journeys. The France scores lowest, what we just saw in the graphs as well. Then we saw that media and publishing is the best scoring vertical when it comes to consent. Most of the organizations that we saw, they fulfill some of the GDPR requirements for consent. There are not a lot of organizations that don't have anything in place, so that are uncompliant across the board. I will go back to the previous sheet to show you that the dark gray has almost disappeared. That is uncompliant across the board. So that's when nothing is in place. So there, no one of consent is not being asked for. In most of the cases, we saw that consent is a thing, that consent is being asked for or mentioned in a privacy statement, but the way that it is done is in most cases not sufficient. So the purpose of use is either vague or not mentioned or not specified per attribute. So that is what we see with consent, and that is why organizations do something about it but don't score very high. We see also that 12.4% is almost or fully compliant when it comes to consent, and that's a doubled versus our May measurement. So we see that some work has been done, but 60% is nowhere near the legal consent requirements. And I've got an example here of how you could do that with consent. In this case, during the registration process with a media company, someone has to fill in the country where they live. And there is very clear what's this for with the purpose of use that's being indicated. And that is per field. So for every field, there is a what's this for button. And you can read what they use it for. And that is really the way we think consent should be implemented in these kind of customer journeys. And then we've got the next requirement. That's the ability to withdraw. According to the GDPR legislation, consent should be withdrawn just as easy as it was given. And what we measured was whether a data controller makes the individual aware of the fact that his consent can be revoked. So in 7.9% of cases, the ability to withdraw is not addressed at all. That means that in 92.1% of the cases, the ability to withdraw is addressed. But what we see is that it's the way that it's done is very important. So most organizations have some sort of ability to withdraw in place. We see a lot of green, so they scored a yes on this requirement. But the way they've done it is questionable because in most cases it's not as easy as it was to give the consent. In most cases, the ability to withdraw is pointed out in a privacy statement, and then there's always a part in the privacy statements how to exercise my rights, and then there's the contact information of a DPO, so a consumer knows that he can contact the DPO to withdraw his consent, but that is a very not so frictionless way of revoking consent. So what we believe is the ideal way is in the screen that you see on the right side of the sheet. Here is a demo of what we believe should be implemented in a registration and login platform. For every attribute, we've got mandatory consent rules. So rules that are mandatory either for a legitimate interest or for a legal purpose. And one of the other purposes that are mentioned in Article 6 of the GDPR. And then you've got the additional consent rules. So these are actually the consent variables that you really filled in yourself, that you gave active consent for. So in this case, it's an email address may be used for third-party interested segments. But it's also very easy to revoke that. It's switched on now, but it can also be switched off very easy for a user. And that is also for the other ones. So that is actually the way that we believe it should be arranged. And in this case, it's just as easy to withdraw the consent as it was to give it. And the next one is right of access. Right of access was implemented in a lot of privacy statements. So it was mentioned in almost every organization mentions it, just not in Switzerland. You see that in the graph. And what we were actually surprised about when we started doing the research, we had a very simple yes-no measurement here for the right of access. Is it mentioned yes or no? And is it pointed out there for the consumer? But then we measured the United Kingdom. And the funny thing there was that if you want to have an extract of personal data, you are charged with a fee for that. So that's when we decided that we would also measure on is it free of charge, yes or no. What we now see that the UK was the exception in all the measurement rounds that we did so far, but now that GDPR has come into force, that has changed. So the UK has really changed that part, and the right of access is free of charge now for the consumers. And what we still see in Switzerland, there are a few organizations that don't mention the right of access. And there was also just one case left that does mention the right, but doesn't offer it free of charge. But if you really want to have a consumer in control and really want to be, in a trusting relationship with the consumer, that is something, one of the basics that you should offer this right free of charge. Then we've come to the right of rectification. That's also one that we measured by looking if it was mentioned anywhere and if the right was pointed out to consumers. And in our sample, it's only a very small amount, 4.5% of the organization do not mention the right of rectification at all. And in May, that was still 31.5%. So that is a huge difference. And we see that, this is one that a lot of work has been done upon. But what I do think as well is that this is also one that is not too hard to implement. This is actually right of rectification. Yeah, you can put it in your privacy statement. You can have that right there, and then you're done. You can have at another point on your checklist, your GDPR checklist, and you're happy. So, but that is something that is not really consumer minded. You know, you have the right in place. It is pointed out, but how easy is it really to rectify your data? An example is below, where you can see that it can be really really clear in a privacy statement. You see here that you can ask us to correct any information about you which is incorrect. This comes out of a part in the privacy statement where the consumer's rights are addressed very clearly. And then you come to the part how you can exercise that right, and then it becomes a bit more complicated. So companies have the right of rectification, but the way they have it is something that we did not assess, but what we observed during our research, and that is not always that easy for a consumer to rectify data in a fast and clear way. The right to erasure, also known as the right to be forgotten. This right is mentioned in a lot of cases. We see that Netherlands, the United Kingdom, Germany, France, all these countries have the right in place and mention it and point it out to the consumer. In previous measurements, there was still a majority that did not point out this right. So we see that there's still around 10% that do not point it out, especially in Spain. Also Switzerland again. We see that Switzerland, they come back in every graph as the country that is still a bit behind. And you will also see that at the end when we've got all of the results in one graph. So the next one is data retention periods. That is one of the more complicated aspects also of GDPR. Most countries did not have this one in their previous privacy regulations. So for most countries, this is also something new to implement. And what we measured is the period for which consumers' data will be stored. Is that specified? Only 42% of all organizations did mention a data retention period. And in November and May, that was way less. In our first measurement, it was 11%. In May, it was 22%. So you see some improvement during the months. But then you see that after GDPR kicked in, there's a large improvement. So that date really was a trigger. What we see with data retention periods is that most organizations, they mention it in general. Like we have a data retention period of a certain amount of months, or we keep your data as long as needed to fulfill the purpose it was collected for. That is actually kind of vague, and that doesn't specify what happens to which data. For example, you always have different kinds of data that you need to keep, for example, for tax purposes, but there's also data that you can just throw away without any problems. And for the different types of data, you should have specific data retention periods. We see here in the example at the bottom of the sheet, we see an example of quite a clear data retention period from a retailer. And what they do, they say, we will keep your data as long as you are an active customer, and they specify it. For customers with an account or club membership, we will keep your personal data for 36 months after your last purchase, and for customers with a guest account for 6 months. So that is quite clear. I believe that it could be specified way more if you look at the different attributes. You could add a data retention period per attribute. And I think in the end, eventually, that will be the way to go and to really give consumers the control of their data. Privacy by default is also a more complex thing, because in every organization, you've got the battle between marketeers and the legal staff and IT staff. And what you see with privacy by default, processes should be designed from the beginning with the consumer's opt-out in mind. So a consumer should never have to actively opt out of any extra communications. The default setting should be that consumers don't get unwanted emails or unwanted correspondence or offers. So what we say often, that it's about pre-tick boxes. So that's a bit, in this example, it is the opposite, because this is a box that needs to be ticked in order not to receive information about third-party products or services. And that is not according to privacy by default. This box should either be pre-ticked or should be reversed with I want to receive information, and then with an active opt-in by a consumer. What we see is that still 39.3% of all organizations do not design their online environment according to privacy by default. So we see that this is one that is really needs some work. And here, the Netherlands scores lowest and France scores best. And that was really funny, in my opinion, because privacy by default is also one of the requirements that really put a consumer first. And if the French get that, why don't they get the consent? Because that is what they score lowest. I think if the French, if they're really focused on consent, they could be world's champion when it comes to GDPR as well. let me see for the next one. That's special categories of data, the sensitive personal data that we speak about then. Does the organization ask for explicit consent when making use of sensitive data? That is what we measured. Not all the organizations in our sample make use of those data. When they did not make use of it, we did not measure it. So we looked at organizations who process these special categories of data. And that's more than you would think. I think if you think about sensitive personal data, health comes to mind, maybe racial or ethnic origin, religious beliefs, but all those things, it's not just health organizations or hospitals that deal with it. It can also be, for example, an insurance company who asks you about your health, or a travel company who, when you go on a group tour, you have to fill in your diet requirements, for example. In that case, you can also reveal your either religious beliefs or diet information, which is actually health information. And then there's a lot of smartwatch companies, for example, that also collect health information, all kinds of apps that do this. So in more cases than you would think, special categories of data are being processed. And what we saw in the research is that 52% was compliant in our sample, and they asked for explicit consent when the sensitive personal data were processed. In November, this was still 26.9%. And in March, this was, March, that should be May, I think, that was 49.2%. So what you see is that this is one of the things that companies thought about for a longer time. They implemented this in the months before GDPR, because this is not a real last minute thing that you can implement. It is really a way of dealing with these kind of sensitive data. So I've shown you a little bit per attribute how we measured it, the most important outcomes, and also what we think are the best practices and good use cases. So now I've got some final sheets for you about the overall GDPR score. You can see here per country that the United Kingdom and Germany both score very well. Germany is very privacy-minded. We also saw that during the research that now after GDPR, they're very precise in their descriptions. We see a lot of article numbers that are really mentioned within the privacy statements. So it can also be the German preciseness that they are famous for, but it's also the way they have always dealt with privacy. It's a privacy aware country. The United Kingdom has some front runners that really help get the country focused on this. We see that Switzerland stays behind. Spain also stays behind. Switzerland is actually explicable because of their status as not an EU country. But with only a few months to go before their own regulation, there is still a lot of work to do there as well. We see that Sweden made a remarkable development. In the beginning, they were scoring amongst the worst of the countries, and they're on the third place now. So they did a lot of things. They implemented a lot of things. So that's interesting to see. The difference between the United Kingdom and Germany, by the way, it looks like Germany has more bright green in the graph. And yet the United Kingdom is number one overall, but that is because the average of the scorings in the United Kingdom was higher. And you see here the average score per country. You see that here, United Kingdom scored 8.24, Germany scored 8.16, and these are all out of 10, these scores. So Sweden is a very good third, and then you see the Netherlands and France a little bit in the middle, and then Spain and Switzerland, they follow. But you also see the development here in all the measurement rounds, and you see that the United Kingdom, for example, really made a very good development from 4.7 69 to 8.24. So that's really a good way. And what you also see is that it's just small steps with every measurement round. From November till January, you see just a few percentages improvement. And then from January to March, the same. From March to early May, the same. And now post GDPR, you see that, huger leaps were made, still not completely compliant, but I think a lot of work has been done. For industry, on an industry level, you see the same. Also, leaps that have been made over the last period, but you see now here in the overview that non-profits really stays behind. Media and publishing and retail and e-tail do a very good job. That might be because these are the industries that really interact a lot with consumers. So they need to be front runners. Nonprofit is remarkable because you would think that they have social responsibility high in their company standards and profiles. So, but maybe it's also just about trust, that they think people are donating money, they want us to keep them posted, and they trust us, and that they are a bit more easy on the GDPR part then. So that's something that I think is remarkable. You see it here with the average scores. That nonprofit scores 6.36 out of 10, and retail and consumer products scores 8. So the difference is quite substantial. And you also see where nonprofit comes from. That was 3.5 out of 10 is really a bad score. That was back in November. So a lot has happened, but I think still a lot needs to be done. So overall, we see in the graph here, you see that 2/3 is green, bright green and darker green. So that means that 2/3 has multiple GDPR requirements in place. And that means that the ratio has been reversed, because in our previous measurement in May, that was 1/3 of the companies. So we see a lot of renewed privacy statements, a lot of revised registration processes. So a lot has changed over the last month, actually. From November to early May, we saw a slow but steady improvement of 13% overall. But now the actual date, we see that was a real trigger to get things done. So over just 2 months difference in May and in June, we see that big of a difference in the measurements. But this also means that 33.7% of the Europe's largest organizations is still uncompliant in multiple areas. And these large organizations should actually pave the way for smaller organizations. They have the resources. They are the first ones that will be on the radar of the authorities. So then I believe, even though we see that a lot of things have improved, then I believe that 33.7% is still a high percentage of organizations that are still uncompliant. And what we see is that basic GDPR rights, we saw it with the right of access and rectification in the graphs, these rights are in place. I have to add that it's in privacy statements, and the way the companies do it is sometimes questionable. But we also see that complicated requirements need further attention, and those are consent, data retention policies, privacy by default, and also sensitive data. So overall, I think we can conclude that the focus is not on the consumer. If you see which rights are in place, which rights have been implemented, and the way they have been implemented, it has been a checklist. So the consumer is not in control. DPOs are happy because they have the rights in their privacy statements. Companies are happy because they can show that they have the rights. But still, you don't put the consumer in charge of their own data. I think that's a missed opportunity to build trusted relationships, but that's in the end what GDPR is about. It is about regaining that trust and save the consumers for this marketing obsessed and data driven world that we live in. What I already mentioned, larger organizations will need to pave the way for smaller ones. And what I also believe is that the complex requirements will need a framework of best practice. That is what we also see. That I think it's not just that companies don't want to invest in it, they don't want, it's also a question of they don't know how to implement it. And especially with requirements like consent, I really understand that, because it's so complicated to put it in your systems and to have a workable way for both the consumer and on the backside, the organization to master the data. So in that aspect, IT is really pivotal to reach goals for both sides. So it's good to see that there are initiatives to build frameworks. As I welcome, we are involved in the Kantara Initiative Workgroup for Consent Management Solutions. Our VP Product, Corné van Rooij, is chairing this work group. And I think very important work is being done here. Frameworks are being created, and hopefully companies will profit from that. And in the end, the consumer, because it's all about the consumer that needs to be protected. And in our view, yeah, it is about building trusted relationship with consumers. And you can do that by having good consent management solutions in place. It will become more and more important. We see that also in the market. There's more and more organizations that really come to us specifically for that part, for consent management. Yeah, absolutely believe that this is an opportunity for front runners to outsmart the competition. Yeah, it's about investing in empowering the customers and yeah, give customers back the control over their personal data. So that was actually what I wanted to share with you in this webinar. I am checking now if there are any questions. I don't see anything coming in. There's someone here. Oh yeah. Are the data retention periods, are they audited? And if not, what is to prevent the company keeping data they have promised to delete? Yeah, that's a good question. So the question is, are the data retention periods and the data retention policies audited independently? Well, of course, the authorities will do that. We were not able to do it because the way we did our investigation was by field research. We acted as if we were a consumer. So we did not have access to the back-end systems of organizations. We only had access to the front end, and we could log in, we could register, we could make a profile, we could read privacy policies. That is where we saw that data retention periods are in place sometimes, but how specific they are and if the data are actually deleted from all systems, that is something that we have not been able to measure. So that is one of the limitations of our research. Yeah, the internal part of organizations, yeah, that has not been accessible for us. So I hope this is a clear answer to the question. I don't see anything else coming in, so I just want to thank you very, very much for listening and for your attention. What I mentioned in the beginning, the report about this fifth measurement will be published on our website from this afternoon. And I will send an email to all of the attendees of the webinar with a link to the report, so that you will have access to the data and a bit more, even a bit more than you had now in the webinar. So that will be maybe good for you to read through. So I'd like to thank you very much for your attention. I'm wishing you a very good afternoon, morning, wherever you are, and hope to see you again for our next webinar. Thank you.